Grace City. Stand and sing with us.
So little else. to be one with you. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, rest in this place and teach us how to be one with you.
Teach us how, Lord. soften their hearts, Lord, for us to receive whatever it is that you have for us, God, that we won't walk out of here the same way that we walked in, God. We praise you, Jesus. We praise you, Jesus. We desire to just rest in your presence, God. Your sweet presence, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
I feel like in this room this morning, I feel like there's a different access to power in this room. You know what I'm saying? I feel like, and not to downgrade first service, but I feel like there's just something different about the atmosphere in this room now than there was at 9:15 this morning. And I believe that's because there are people in this room that are going to continue to walk through a breakthrough starting right now and continuing the rest of their life. I believe that right now, people are, yeah, amen. I believe right now there are chains that are broken in someone's life right now. I believe right now there are walls coming tumbling down. I believe right now people's preconceived notions of church is coming tumbling down, and that we can simply operate in the power and the protection and the freedom of the Holy Spirit. I love that song, Holy Spirit, come. Just rest in this place. Just rest. Father God, I pray right now, God, whatever I wanted to say is gone. Can I just pray right now that you would allow us to, the ability and the surrender to walk through our life, surrendering to your power, surrendering to your word. And as we surrender to you, this crazy thing happens. The more that we surrender to your power and the more we surrender to your word, the more freedom we have in our lives. And God, I thank you for the freedom. I thank you for the cross. I thank you for going to a cross, the Mount of Golgotha, 2,000 years ago, to live a life we couldn't live, to die a death we deserve, to be hung up on a cross, naked, beaten, ashamed, accused, spit at, ridiculed, and mocked. Just so this day, 2,000 years ago, we can stand in humble adoration of who you are with your power and protection all around us in this room this morning. Jesus Christ, you are good. You are sure. You are true. We thank you, Lord, for your Ruach HaKodesh, Lord, that your Holy Spirit that dwells inside of us, that Yeshua, you are the Messiah just to live for us. And we thank you for the cross. We thank you for your life. And I thank you, God, for this atmospherical shift that he brought this morning at 11 a.m. And I pray, God, this church service right now will be a catalyst of change for our future. And Jesus Christ, it is in your sweet and perfect and precious name we pray and praise. Amen. Guys, as we continue our worship through communion, I just want to say something real quickly. So simple. You guys start passing them out now. So simple. If you don't know this, this is all people who are new to church. The bread represents the body of Christ that was broken on the cross, and the juice represents his blood that was shed on the cross for our freedom. If you guys are online, we want to say thank you for streaming online. We're so excited to see you guys, kind of excited you can see us because we're awesome, right? And God's so good here at Grace City, and we're excited for you guys. I hope you guys are doing well. Wherever you're watching, I pray if you're watching right now, you can share the link and give it to a friend so they can have a renewal and an amazing spirit this morning. Also, if you guys are here at Grace City Church and you're like, I didn't bring any cash, and it's, oh, dang it, that's okay. You guys can actually give on our app in Grace City Mo. You can do that. You can also give in the giving kiosk in the lobby with a card, or you can just do it online. It's so simple, so quick.
You're shattered. Never been before. The life you knew, a thousand pieces on the floor. It was for sure times like these when this world drives you to your knees. You think you're never gonna get back to the you that used to be. Tell your heart to beat again.
just worship him for just a moment? Hallelujah. Lord, we love you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's worthy, church. He's worthy to be praised. That song there that Travis just sang, a song by Danny Gokey, and it says to tell your heart to beat again. How many's ever been wounded before? How many's ever been hurt? How many's ever had something wrong done to you? The story behind that song was he heard the story of a pastor that wanted to see a heart surgery done. So I guess there was a doctor in the church, and this family agreed that, you know, that the pastor could watch the process. And if you've ever been around somebody that's had open heart surgery before, you realize what man has to do to keep a heart alive, but how God made this. Amen? And he made you. So the doctor did everything that, you know, that they do, and they don't put the heart back in until they know that it starts again. I mean, that's a good thing. So the heart's there, and they're doing it, and they're just waiting. Nothing happens. They try some other stuff. Nothing happens. Finally, the doctor did something that he had never done before. He leaned over into Mrs. Johnson's ear, and he said, "Mrs. Johnson, we have done everything that we know how to do, but you must tell your heart to beat again." And they said the minute the doctor said to tell your heart to beat again, they said the heart began to beat. Church, I'm telling you, we've all been wounded. We all carry scars and hurts and pains, but I believe that the Holy Spirit today is whispering in your ear saying, tell your heart to beat again. Yeah. Yeah. That God is not the one that hurts you. And sometimes we feel that in church. I've been there in life, and we go through hurts and pains. The thing that we need the most is sometimes the things that we run away from the most. We don't need to run from God, but we need to learn how to run to God. How many understands that God's not angry anymore? God is not mad at you. All the things that you've done, the things you wish you could change, you cannot change them. But the guilt and shame can be taken away. The Bible tells us that Jesus bore all the guilt, all the shame upon a cross 2,000 years ago for you. Amen? Everybody look at your neighbor and say, tell your heart to beat again. And sometimes those things sound easy, but it's not always so easy. Really what the doctor was telling Mrs. Johnson, it was this. He says, more or less, this is my take on it, but I feel like the doctor was telling her, you got to trust the process. God wants you to know today that you can trust the process. It may not always look the way that you want it to look. It may not always seem to turn out the way that you want it to turn out. But God is always working things for your good. I'm going to share something real quick, and this is something I really feel like I just want to share for a moment. And I think I may have shared this, but talking about my daughter for just a moment, Savannah. We adopted her from India many years ago. And, you know, I remember watching a video of her the first time we saw her, where all the other kids in this playpen had a book of their forever families. And she didn't have a book. We had just found out about her. We had just started the process. And to me, she was already mine. So as her dad, I'm standing there pointing at the video going, we're coming, Savannah. We're coming. And see, in her world, every day she woke up to the same thing. The same problems. The same people. The same things looked the same way. But what she did not know is that clear on the other side of the world, God was working on her behalf. I'm here to tell you today that if you wake up to the same mess, the same problems, by faith, you need to say, but God is working on my behalf somewhere. Because we don't walk by sight, we walk by faith. We don't always see everything that's going on. So trust the process. Because what the enemy meant for your harm, God is able to turn around and use it for your good. Amen? Hallelujah. God is so good. I want to start off with this. Would be even if. We need to learn how to get an even if faith. Even if it doesn't turn out the way that I think it should. Even if it doesn't look the way that it should. I'm going to believe what he says about me and what the word has to say. Because see, my plans are usually what's best for me. Right? Some of you got some of those plans, don't you? You know, where we tell God, yeah, that's a good plan, God, but wait till you hear mine. God's plan is much bigger. The Bible tells us very clear that his ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. You know, how many is glad that God doesn't get up every morning at 3 o'clock in the morning to try to make the plan for your life? The Bible tells us that he sees the end from the beginning. He's been where you are. He's been where you've been. He's been where you are. And he's already been where you're going. That's why the Bible can tell us that he goes before us and he makes a way where there seems to be no way. If you need mercy in a situation today, God is your mercy. If you need grace today, God is your grace. If you need healing today, God is your healing. That's why he can say, I am the I am. Because whatever you need him to be, that's what he is. God says that if you need deliverance, I am deliverance. If you need salvation, God says, I am salvation. Even if. I'm going to read a scripture in John real quick. I'm going to try to. My opening took about 3/4 of my message in the first service, so I'm going to try to trim that down a little bit. But in John 8:32, and I'm going to read John 8:31 to start off with. I'm going to do 31 and 32. says this. It says, then Jesus said to those Jews who believed him, if you abide in my word, everybody say his word. He says, then you are my disciples indeed. In verse 32, and then you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. How many understands that there's a lot of facts in life? How many's ever went to the doctor and got some facts that things aren't well? How many's looked at your checking book and realized that there's facts? Right? But the good news is that there's a truth. And I believe God's word is the truth. And the truth will override the facts any day. See, but truth, we can quote scripture, which is all good, but somewhere down the line, it has to be put into action. The Bible says, don't just be a hearer of the word, but be you a doer of the word. If God tells you to walk, you walk. God tells you to stay, you stay. If he tells you to speak, you speak. If he tells you to, you know, quiet, That's the hard one, isn't it? How many's ever done that before? Where you just knew the Holy Spirit was like, don't say it. Don't say it. And then you go, bleh. And then all of a sudden you go, why'd I say it? Because then that other person looking at you going, you shouldn't have said that. I mean, knows that God's pretty smart sometimes. God wants us to be free from bondages, from mindsets. Your mind is the battlefield. This is where the battle takes place. This is where the voices tell you that things will never change. This is where the voices tell you that you're not good enough. This is where the voice will tell you that you can't do it. That this is the way it was for your parents and your grandparents, so this is the way it's going to be for you. Don't believe the lies today. How many's ever been to the circus? I'm not talking about your house. I'm talking about the true circus with the big tent thing, okay? I was going to go into the clowns, but never mind. We go on that one. How many's ever seen the elephants when they're tied up, that here's this huge animal tied up to a little bitty chain, to this little bitty stake that's in the ground? And we all know by looking at that, we're thinking, that can't hold that elephant. But see, from very little, he was trained or she was trained. They put that big old chain on when they're little and they try to break loose and they can't. Their mind has been made to believe that they can't break the chain. So here's this huge animal now that when they begin to tug, it holds them. And in their mind, they say, I can't break free. You and I have been told some of the same things, that you'll never break free from what you're in. That you can never stay married because no one else stays married. You can't break the addiction because it's too big, it's too strong. Right? Who's ever heard the old saying about sticks and stones may break my bones, but the words will never hurt me? How many knows that's a lie? Because I broke arms and legs. And I've healed from that, but there's still times that I will deal with words that people speak over me. Words are sharp, and sometimes they're hard to escape. It's the mind. We must change the mind today. So today we're going to reboot. All right? When I'm at camp and we have internet problems, I have one answer. Unplug it, reboot it. And then the IT calls me from St. Louis. They're like, it looks like you guys had a power surge. Oh, we did. That's my answer to everything. So everybody look at your neighbor and say, we're going to change our minds today. So all the lies, you know, sometimes even as we were little kids, sometimes things that were spoken over, it's not even meant to be spoken in harm, has wounded us. When I was in high school, I'll share this, and I've never shared this with very many people. When I was in high school, I've always been short, as you can guess that one, but I've always been really stocky. I was a weightlifter, I figured out early in life I was not going to be a basketball player. But I had a coach one time just jokingly, in a joking manner, said, Terry, you're fat. And this teacher was one of my favorite teachers. For the next 2 years, I battled bulimia. All because of a word that was spoken in a joke, the enemy stepped in. Sometimes the world tells us things that aren't true. That's why the Bible tells us to do what? Take every thought captive, and you line it up with the Word of God. And you believe what the Word says about you and not what anybody else says about you. The Bible tells us that we are the apple of His eye, that there is no one else like you. He created you to be you. We don't look at ourselves. We don't judge ourselves against other people. How many of us say if you begin to do that, you're going to do one of two things to yourself? If you look at someone else and you say, well, you're either going to make yourself really up here because you're going to say, well, at least I didn't do what they did. Or you're going to put yourself really low because you're going to say, I didn't do what they did. You're either going to let pride step in if you compare yourself to someone else, or condemnation is going to step in. Guess who we compare ourselves to? Christ. There's no other level. There's nothing else that we compare ourselves into. We compare ourselves to Christ. Amen? That's good news. How many wants to be set free today? It's a choice. Don't believe the lies any longer. John 10:10 says this. Remember in 8:31 where it talks about the word. The word is what's important. The word is the truth, and it sets people free. Trust the process. John 10:10 says this. The thief does not come except to steal, to kill, and destroy. I have come that you may have life and that you may have it more abundantly. We serve a God that is not a God of just enough or a God of lack. He's a God of more than enough. See, because he wants you and I to have enough to give away to someone else. We're blessed to be a blessing, whether that be in word. Bible tells us what? To love your neighbor as you love yourself. If you do not love yourself, sooner or later you will not love your neighbor. If you're constantly putting yourself down, sooner or later you'll begin to put everybody else down. Begin to see yourself through God's eyes. Years ago, I had a friend of mine that called, and there was a gentleman that he knew that had a brain tumor. And he asked if I would go pray with him. He wasn't doing well. The gentleman's name was John. And I said, yes, I'll go. And on the way out there, the Holy Spirit spoke to me. And he said, when you get there, pray for his heart. And in my great wisdom, I said, no, that's the wrong person. He's got a brain tumor. I'm saying this to myself, you know, in our great wisdom here. And the Holy Spirit says, no, when you get there, you pray for his heart. And again, my hard-headed, wrong guy. We'll talk later. So we get out there, and John's sitting there, and he's talking, and he's sharing about all the treatments, and they've done all they can do. But I know the voice of God. And he said, ask him about his heart. I said, John, this may sound crazy. I said, but how's your heart? And I said, I don't think this is a physical thing. I think there's more to it than that. And big tears welled up in his eyes and began to roll down his cheek. He said, 20 years ago, I went through a divorce. Everything I worked for my whole life, she took from me. And you could see the anger and you could see the hurt welling up inside of him. And he says, every time I see her, and they lived really, with, you know, I mean, we lived in Cuba, Missouri, so how many times you're not going to see somebody? And he says, every time I see her, he says, I get so angry, I almost get sick. For 20 years, his unforgiveness had eaten him up like a cancer from the inside out. Church, unforgiveness is one of the strongest strongholds that the enemy will put on you. Sometimes it's unforgiveness for yourself. Sometimes it's easier for us to forgive others than it is ourselves. But so what you got to understand, if you have unforgiveness, it is a stronghold in your life. The Bible tells us that our weapons are not carnal, but they're mighty through him for pulling down strongholds in our lives. See, when you forgive someone, that forgiveness is more for you than it is the other person. Because what it does is it frees you from that situation because you did the right thing. If you've never been there, trust me, someday you will have to do the right thing when everyone else is doing the wrong thing. Just because everyone else is doing it doesn't make it right. See, the world will tell you that it's okay to bend a little bit. Well, you can try this because it's not going to hurt you. You can watch that because it's okay because everybody else watches it. It's the number one show. All it is the bait to try to pull you away little by little. I mean, it says that the enemy can be patient also. If the enemy can't get you today, he'll get you tomorrow. God's got a plan. Guess what? So does the enemy. And his plan is out to steal, kill, and destroy. He can do nothing else other than that. And Jesus said this, though. He said, what? I've come to give you life. And life more abundant. How many wants to live in the abundance? That's the God that we serve. Don't allow unforgiveness to hold you. I want to read a little story to you out of Daniel for just a moment. Even if, anybody's ever heard of Daniel before? Daniel in the lion's den? Daniel had three friends, though. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Anybody ever heard of them before? At this time, Israel was underneath Babylonian control. Nebuchadnezzar was the king. Daniel had just interpreted some things for Nebuchadnezzar, so he was kind of hip on Daniel's God a little bit. But all of a sudden, he got this idea to make this big golden statue. I mean, how many knows the world is good about making it all about me? So he made this statue. And all of a sudden, they began to. All these friends said, "Well, here's what we're going to do. When this music, when we start playing the music, how many knows that music moves us, right? Worship in the church is a huge, huge thing. I grew up in Stillville, Missouri, and we cruised the strip in Stillville. That's what we did, back and forth, back and forth, and you've seen the same 15 people all night long." And you knew who they was just by their headlights. You knew what kind of vehicle. Oh, that's old Bobby Joe. Hello, Bobby Joe. And we waved. And we did this all the time. And what we'd do is we'd change the way that we waved at each other just to do something new. We had the old, hey. You know, then you had the, hey, hey. And then we had this one. I still to this day, we did this. And I'm not sure what that was, but that's just the way we. So we changed things up a lot. We were pretty. You know, we were pretty diverse back in those days. But you understand, back then, if you pulled up to somebody's vehicle, you knew how they were doing just by the music they were listening to. Amen? I was an 80s child, or I grew up in the 80s. I was a 60s child, I guess. But anyway, we won't talk about that. I grew up in the 80s. And you'd pull up to somebody's vehicle, and you knew, our heart. And we're talking about emotions a little bit. How many of your emotions can lead you wrong real quick? That we don't need to be led by our emotions, even though God gave them. Somehow we got to understand that we can't be led by our emotions. But, you know, when everything was good, when you had your girlfriend and everything was good, you know, you listened to Journey. You know, and when things were good, you were going, I'm forever yours, faithfully. You know, you're just, woo, it's all good. Then 2 weeks later, you pull up next to the car and you hear Air Supply on the radio going, I'm all out of love. I'm so lost without you. You know, we live by emotions way too much sometimes. I still like those songs. Anyway, oh my. Anyway. So they made this statue. And they said, whoever does not bow will be thrown into the fiery furnace. How many has ever been put through the fiery furnace of life? See, sometimes it's not about what you're doing wrong. Sometimes in life it's actually about what you're doing right. You see, the enemy wants to take you off the course, your destiny that God has for you. So here's this. All of a sudden, the three Hebrew children decide they're not going to bow. And I love it because they had an even if faith. No matter what everybody else is doing, we're going to believe what God said for us to do, and we're not to bow to any other gods. And they were in the higher ups, even in this right now. They'd been put over some things, and they were kind of with the king and all this. But all of a sudden it says the king came up to them and said, one more chance. If you do not bow, we're going to throw you into the fiery furnace. Church, don't give the devil a maybe, or I'll get back to you later. You give the devil the answer that he deserves, and that's a no. We sing a song, what? Not today. So you need to learn how to tell the devil no. So they told the king no, and he got mad. So he heats the furnace up to 7 times hotter than it was before. It was so hot that even the people that they bound them in bondage, and they threw them in there, even the people that threw them in, it says the heat took their lives because it was so hot. Church, let me tell you, and sometimes in life, it'll seem like people around you that may fail and fall, but that doesn't mean you have to. And even if faith. And here's what I love about this story. They talk about, and the three Hebrew children said this about, they said, will you bow? And they said, no. And in the NIV, I love what it says. It says, no matter what happens, we know that our God can deliver us, but even if he does not, we will not bow to your image. And even if faith, even if it doesn't look the way that I think it should, I will not bow. I will not give in. I'm just telling you, when you can tell the devil no, you'll begin to feel chains being broken off your life. And it's not always easy. Trust me, been there, done that. So they throw them in. And Nebuchadnezzar, like I said, he knew these guys a little bit. So he jumps up and he looks in. And he asks all his buddies, he says, wait a minute, didn't we throw 3 into the fire? And they're all like, yeah. And he's like, well, there's 4 in there. God's word is true. And he promises to never leave us nor forsake you. He doesn't hang with you like sometimes our friends will hang when everything's good. They leave when everything's bad. God is with you through the good and the bad and the ugly. He will be with you. So 3 things took place as I get ready to close. So he calls them out. One, it says that they didn't even smell like smoke. How many believes that you can go through something and come out better on the other side than you was when you went in? Because see, the Bible tells us very clearly what the enemy meant for harm, God is able to turn around and use it for good. See, it's not only for you, but there's people watching us, church. How are we going to handle the tough situations? It's easy to give God praise when everything's good. But what happens when God all of a sudden allows something, we just have to walk through something with him? We love the deliverance part. But can you trust him through the hard part? Do we just have a mountaintop Christianity, or are we willing to do a valley Christianity? Though I walk through the valley. Don't stop. Keep walking. Don't pitch your tent. Keep walking. Don't stay there. Keep walking. So he calls them out, and they says it didn't even smell like smoke. It says that the bondages were burned off, but I love these 2 things. One, God got the glory. The things that you're going through, the enemy's out to tear you down, but God's going to say, it's all for the glory of the kingdom. And God gets the glory. And guess what happened to them, the 3? They got promoted to a higher place. How many of you want to be promoted to a higher place? Bible says that promotion comes from God. If you're at work and you're trying to win man's approval, that's as high as you're going to go. God can take you higher than any man can. God can put you on his ladder. You don't have to climb man's ladder to get to the top. Because it doesn't get any better than being in God's will. And God, David said this. He said, better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. In other words, David knew that God could do in a moment what we couldn't do in a lifetime. Before we sing the song, Isaiah 26:3 says this. It says, he will keep them in perfect peace. How many would love to have perfect peace in your life? So I'm silly enough just to believe it. If God's word says it, I believe it. He says, he will keep them in perfect peace because they trust in him. See, there's no guarantee that you're not going to go through things, but there is a guarantee that you don't have to go through it alone. And if God be for us, who can be against us? God is a good God. And I'll share this story real quick, and I'm going to allow the, just ask the praise team to sing. Even if, I made God a commitment in 1991. He delivered me from alcohol, from a lot of things. And I made him a promise. I said, God, if you can deliver me from this, I'll serve you for the rest of my life. I'll go where you tell me to go. I'll do what you tell me to do. Sounds all big and courageous and bold, doesn't it? Then life happens. We went through a lot of things, Joy and I have, since we've been Christians. I'll just share one, maybe two, but one, in 2003, we were building our new sanctuary. 2 weeks away from our opening service, Father's Day, I get a phone call at 3:00 in the morning. And my dad had been killed in a car wreck. My dad had been calling. He was saying, when's the new building going to be open? My dad didn't go to church very much, but he was going to be in the first service, he said. And I remember going to the church, and I was angry. Because I thought God had let me down. God had missed it somehow. And I remember sitting at the church and I thought, you know, my dad was a truck driver and he drove thousands of miles, millions of miles, I don't know, with all these accolades of how good safe driver he was. 3 miles from his house, a horse standing in the middle of the road on a foggy morning at 3:00 a.m, the state patrolman said he never saw it, he never knew what happened. And I remember telling God, I was like, God, you could split the Red Sea, but you couldn't move a horse. How do I trust that? My heart was broke. And I tell you that to show you that no one is exempt from this church. No one, no matter what title you hold, no matter what you've done, what's going on, things happen. And I remember asking God, why? And the Holy Spirit answered me this two things. He said, one, would why ever be good enough? And I said, no. He said, then all I can do to tell you is, I'm asking you to trust me. And when you feel like, the big question is today is this, will you remain faithful when it seems like your faith didn't work? Because it didn't turn out the way that we thought it should. Can we remain faithful? I'm thankful today to tell you that we serve a God that is faithful no matter what it looks like. No matter what the enemy tells you, God is a faithful God and he has never let you down. I can tell you that I can point at myself and say in the midst of all that, God never let me down. Because he was there. And a lot of situations went on, but God is good. Church, you can trust him today. We're going to have the prayer partners come up if they would as we get ready to go into our altar time. knowing that God is good and that you can trust Him with everything. I encourage you this morning, if you need prayer, if there's unforgiveness in you, if you're battling sickness, if you don't know Him as your Lord and Savior today, that's where we all had to start, the same place, with a step of salvation. We invite you to come up as the praise team sings. Be willing to take the first step saying, God, I trust you. And you'll be amazed at what one step will do for the rest of your life.
Thank you.
this, Lord. Father God, we want to thank you so much for being active in this atmosphere. God, we want to thank you for the power of release, that you've given us power to release strongholds in our past, to allow us to operate in new strength today so we can have a brighter future tomorrow. God, I thank you for the reality that our job as Christians when it comes to painful situations is to always move forward and never look backwards. And God, we know that you've been active in our past. We love to look at our past and see the great things you've done, but we're not camping there, God. You've called us to a great and glorious future. And we hold on to that promise. And we thank you for your protection. We thank you for your power. And Jesus Christ, we love you so much. And in your name we pray. Amen. Grace City Church, I loved this morning. Amen. Can you guys get over Pastor Terry? Yeah. And just to be clear, we're not giving up for Pastor Terry because he's awesome or because he's an amazing husband or an amazing father or an amazing speaker and teacher or an amazing camp director or because he looks awesome, right? We're praising that God has equipped people to simply be his humble servants and do his work and do his calling. Amen. So Pastor Terry, I just want to say thank you so much for that. One thing, and I said this in the last service as well, and I just love the analogy, it hit me so hard, is maybe you brought the analogy up about the elephant, and you go into the circus, you know, and then this idea that there's been times in our past, right, for all of us, that some chain, something, some addiction, some negative mindset, feelings of insecurity or inadequacy, something in the past has held us back, but now that we have Jesus, we are so much stronger with his help, and that we could actually literally just pull the stake out of the ground, break the chain, and finally be free. And I love you brought that reality to our lives that we don't have to be chained to what we used to be chained to. Now we can walk in a newness of life. And I love that you brought up, like, sometimes, guys, we gotta shift our focus, right? We look at this chain, and we're like, the chain's so strong, it's steel. But imagine the God who dwells inside of us, who's a breaker of chains, who died on the cross and raised by his own power 3 days later. See, look at this chain. This chain's nothing. I love that so much. I love that for me. You know, I know we all have stories, we all have past that held us back, and the reality that, man, God's called us to such a greater future. And I love you brought up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that we always have God with us. So it's like, forget the fires, man. God's so good. He's so great. And his faith he's given us is always stronger than the fire that Satan tries to throw us into. So thank you so much, Pastor Terry. I loved it so much. Guys, if you don't know Pastor Terry, you don't know his wife, Jonah, who's the amazing singer who sang our last song. Yeah, man, so what a great power couple. You know what I'm saying? Like, I can't even talk, you know? Like, so Grace City Church, we love you guys so, so much. I hope you guys are blessed from the sermon, blessed from this Sunday, and we hope to see you guys next week. Be blessed and be safe.
Have you been praying and you still have no answer?